For 25 years, the Arkansas Natural Heritage Commission has provided an invaluable service to the people and land of our great state. As governor, I personally invite you to visit these natural areas where our heritage has been preserved for you and for future generations.
This program is made possible in part by the Arkansas Real Estate Transfer Tax through the Arkansas Natural and Cultural Resources Council, and by viewers like you.
In 1973, when I was governor of Arkansas, we established a system to preserve Arkansas's natural areas. We wanted to preserve our heritage, our natural heritage, such as our waterfalls, our bows, and our meadows. We wanted to preserve our heritage precisely the way it was before the first European settler ever set foot on our soil. This is Arkansas's natural heritage. Sprinkled throughout Arkansas are more than 50 natural areas that have been set aside and are being protected by a small, little-known state agency. Some of these places are the only ones of their kind. They have been preserved by the Arkansas Natural Heritage Commission to make sure civilization doesn't swallow them up. Kings River Falls is among the most stunning of all of Arkansas's natural areas. In the spring, when the water's rushing, the river roars over the rock, carving out a priceless Ozark Mountain landscape. The drive to these backwoods is worth the time, and the hike from the parking area is short. The scenery is the reward. Since 1979, the falls have been owned by the state, which has also purchased land up and down the Kings River. Two of the landowners who decided to sell their riverfront property are Ken and Ruan Ewing. They loved this area so much, they wanted to see it protected so it would never lose its natural brilliance.
The ability to enjoy large, undisturbed tracts of ground, the tracts that provide integrity for the forest, for the animal life, it's really important. And the beauty of it's protected forever, and it has access to that. It's and you know, I think our biggest, one of the things that we enjoyed most was bringing people out here so that they could enjoy something that we, you know, so really in effect wasn't our property.
And, right, from the beginning it really wasn't.
The significance of this whole mountain is that there's like five major rivers that come off of here. You know, you've got the Kings River comes off of here, the Mulberry River, the White River, the Buffalo River, and the War Eagle. Plus, it's interesting also to see the power of the water. If you go on downstream, there's boulders in the river system that are big as automobiles or buses, and the water cascades over and around through them.
I think it just restores your soul in a sense to come out and just convene with nature in a spot that's undisturbed. Every little holler along the way is just as spectacular, if not more so, than right here. I feel good about just thinking about all the people that'll be coming out here over the next however many hundred years and, you know, enjoying it.
Adjacent to one of the busiest highways in northwest Arkansas is Searles Prairie, a 10-acre island of natural history surrounded by progress. Anna Mae Searles and her late husband Isaac bought this land in 1939. Early on, they decided to leave the prairie as it is, to save it for the monarch butterflies that stop here every October on their fall migration to Mexico.
They came through here in millions. Millions, just clouds of them. And now I may see four or five butterflies. I guess they've changed their pattern. I don't know. And I hadn't even thought about anything happening to it until a man showed up on my doorstep and wanted me to sign a paper that would give him the authority to run some pipelines across the prairie. He insisted that I sign it, or else he'd just condemn it and take it. And I thought, no, that can't happen.
When Mrs. Searles Prairie was threatened in 1988, she gave the Arkansas Natural Heritage Commission partial ownership so the state could help her protect it.
This is this called a virgin prairie because it's never been cultivated at all to keep the meadow.
Today, in the midst of modern change in the state's most booming region, the prairie serves as an outdoor classroom for students who come to study ecology the way it was.
Okay, well, you can see where I'm standing, and then if you look across the prairie, these tall grasses, they're predominantly big and little blue stem. Big blue stem gets up to 12 feet tall. So when the wagon trains came through, the grasses were over their heads, if you can imagine such a thing. So there's a lot of moisture here. It's really interesting because you can hear them mumbling on the bus. It's like, oh, we're gonna have to get out and walk in that grass. And you know, they're just totally nonplussed when they see it. And by the time you get them in the middle of it, they're really beginning to understand what you mean by tall grass prairie. And by the time we're through and they get to visit with Miss Searles, they're completely taken with the place. And it happens every year. There's a transformation. Mrs. Searles to us is a very important role model, someone who cared so much about her community, that cared so much about education, that she was willing to give this resource to the people of Arkansas, the people of the nation, and we think the kids these days need that role model.
It's a wonderful feeling, and you meet so many wonderful people, and you think you're doing a little good anyway, leaving it for the children.
Seeing now all you can see and then come back.
I don't know if you feel the way I do, but when you get out here, it's just incredible to me, you know, how much there is here and how different it is. And it's just so thick. And just look around at the diverse array of plants that you see around you.
French explorers call these rapids the Skull Crusher. A state park and natural area protects a 10-mile corridor where the cascading water is crystal clear, kept clean by a forest that grows right to the banks of the Cossetot. In late winter and early spring, kayakers shoot the wildest rapids in Middle America with names like Eye Opener, Washing Machine, and Whiplash. Floaters call it riding the Cossetot toilet flush. The river settles down later in the year, for fly fishermen and nature seekers.
The greatest aspects of the river itself is you've got the combination of high water quality, spectacular geological features, and you've got a plant community that, in association with this, that's really special and unique. At Costock Falls, the river's coming around and it's cutting right across one of these east-west ridges, and it's just exposing all this geological formation there as it makes its six rocky drops down through there. And you're looking at, you know, 300 million years of geologic interaction here.
One of the few alterations to this natural setting is a walkway where the highway crosses the river.
It's a pedestrian bridge on its surface, but just beneath this walking surface is a large steel box structure within which is a 36-inch natural gas transmission pipeline. It doesn't just look like a gas pipeline crossing, it really does look like a pedestrian bridge, so that it's not an eyesore. ARCLI purchased 160 acres just across the bridge from us that was in private ownership, developed that for public use, and gave that to the state of Arkansas in compensation for allowing them to transit across this property.
On the banks of the Cossetot River, rare plants have been discovered. Washita twist flower, waterfall sedge, Washita lead plant, granite gooseberry, and chalk maple. The pristine water is home for two species of fish found only in this part of the world, the leopard darter and the Washita mountain shiner.
When people walk down here, they're gonna go, whoa, particularly if it's in the summertime when everything's settled out of the water, and then it's just tap water clear, and you can just see the bottom through there. We want people, when they come here, to be aware this is something special, we're very proud of it, but we want you to help us take care of it.
Falcon Bottoms Natural Area is one of the most intact and undisturbed bottomland hardwood forests in the state. Surrounding Bajo Dorchit is a cypress-tupelo swamp with lakes and sloughs and old-growth forest woven together.
I lived in a different era.
Sarah Johnson grew up in the swamp. Her favorite childhood memories are of the time she spent here with her grandfather, who made his living trapping and logging in woods known as Rattlesnake Bottoms.
His name was Van Buren Sullivan, and in the early 1900s, he came here and bought 160 acres, paid $1.25 an acre for it. And at that time, everybody says it was a virgin forest. He was concerned about the wildlife and the trees, and I think that taught me a lot of respect for it, too.
As long as she can remember, it's been Sarah's dream to protect the forest where she played as a child. Sarah lobbied hard for the natural area and encouraged private landowners to stop cutting the trees so the woods could be saved.
This was almost clear cut weeks before we were able to convince one of the paper companies not to cut it.
Thank you.
we finally did talk International Paper Company into selling us 240 acres. But the thing they did of almost equal importance is that they put 11,000 acres of their land in the Dorchit watershed into a management agreement with us. What a partnership enables us to do is that we don't have to spend a lot of money to buy land. We can work with other private landowners in other ways, with easements or leases or things like this, and have them involved, and so the project can become a 20,000 acre project instead of a 1,000 acre project.
We're a partner in this project with the Heritage Commission because they accomplish what they want to accomplish, and we accomplish what we want. They get protection of the resource. We still get production of timber products, but doing it in a way that protects the resource. So we both get something and we both give something. And they've given us expertise in protection of the ecology, the ecological values. We bring some expertise in how to manage the forest. So we both give and we both get something out of the project.
This is an ecosystem to itself. It's self-maintaining. The bio makes it because it's a large watershed. There's numerous creeks and springs all over the bottom area, and that's what keeps it going. And over the years, that's what's kept the loggers out for the most part, because it's been so muddy and hard to log. It's been too expensive. It's just so beautiful. You can see for yourself. It's something that there's not a lot of anymore.
This place is a puzzlement.
Warren Prairie lies in an old floodplain of the Saline River. It's Arkansas's largest salt prairie, one of the most unusual places in this part of the country. Loblolly pines and hardwoods surround large treeless areas where the salty soil is toxic to most plants.
One look at this tree tells you that it's struggling with something, and in this case we know what it's struggling with. It's the salt in the soil.
The plants that do grow here have adapted to the sodium and magnesium salts. The most uncommon is geocarpon, the only plant in Arkansas on the federal threatened list. Less than 1 inch in height, it often goes through its entire life cycle, from sprouting to producing seeds, in about 3 weeks of early spring.
Most of the geocarpon is around these areas that we call slicks. This is a center of a slick here, and there's no green plant growing here at all. This is probably because this is saltier than any of the other soil that's exposed.
And notice the flat profile of the head kind of reminds you of a grasshopper sparrow.
Right, same genus.
Warren Prairie is an ideal site for birders in quest of rare sparrows. It is the only protected place in the state where Henslow's sparrows are known to winter.
Very nice bird, rare bird too. It's a good idea to set aside lands like this because it provides habitat for these species that are just barely hanging on, that require specific habitats to survive in. And this habitat is just right for wintering grounds for the Henslow sparrow, and there's so little of it around.
We want people to know about this place. We want them, as far as their interest carries them, to study the rare plants and animals that are specific to this kind of place. Thank you.
Heritage Commission, we're about science and nature, but we're about heritage, and this is heritage.
Before settlers arrived, much of eastern Arkansas looked like this. Swamps covered 24 million acres along the lower Mississippi River. Most of the bottomland hardwood forest had been cleared for farming, and only a few places like Benson Creek Natural Area have survived.
Arkansas has experienced the greatest clearing of bottomland forest and swamp of any state in the Southeast. Certainly in these low bottom lands, this is the way it looked. It is very typical of what a wet swamp forest ought to look like.
Some of the cypress trees in these bottoms are more than 700 years old.
Within the area, these ancient cypresses that are really the biggest cypress that I've seen in Arkansas. They're very broad in diameter, and they keep that diameter all the way up to the canopy. I like touching it. I think at this time of year in particular, as the trees are changing color, the swamp is as pretty a place as there is in Arkansas. Bayou de Vieux is as pretty a stream as there is in Arkansas.
Flanagan Prairie, near my hometown of Charleston, Arkansas, is a kaleidoscope of wildflowers. Compass plant, rose pink, rattlesnake master, black-eyed Susan, and poppy mallow. What are these purple blooms that are so prolific all over this 160 acres? What are they called?
Well, the old timers called them gay feathers. Or as one, after I started using, coming out here and using flowers later on to gather to use in church on Sundays, I used a lot of these. And one of the old timers said, "Betty, I didn't know they could be so beautiful. I thought they were only good for getting up your pant leg, stomping hay in a hay baler." But the scientific name for them is liatris.
The prairie was the childhood playground of my wife, Betty. Her father, Babe Flanagan, owned this meadow for 6 decades. In all that time, the land was never plowed.
Well, that's what a virgin prairie means, that it's never been tilled, and it's exactly like it was. I mean, like it was created, like God created it.
In short, that's what really makes
that's
it a natural
right.
area. You know, Betty, your father owned this land for almost 60 years, and you had so many memorable times here as a child. What would you recommend? This land belongs to the people of Arkansas. How would you recommend to them that they use it? It's theirs.
Well, I would like to think that every child in America could have the great, wonderful experience I had coming out here when I was growing up and enjoying this kind of thing. I think probably the best thing that could happen is that we encourage teachers to bring children out here, that it would be worth a wonderful field trip to bring children out to learn about areas like this and to learn to appreciate them even more. I can't think of a better way to take advantage of their tax dollar than that.
Why don't you and I start going out and visiting them, enjoying them ourselves?
It's a great idea.
Our goals is to conserve everything natural that's in Arkansas. And in order to do that, you have to go to the places that are unlike any other.
it's important to save places like this because we can use them as scientific baseline areas for understanding what effect we have on the world. But it's also important because they are a part of Arkansas, they are a part of our heritage, and we need to feel a part of this.
The Arkansas Natural Heritage Commission wishes to gratefully acknowledge the support and partnership of the Nature Conservancy of Arkansas. The Nature Conservancy contributes to the conservation of natural lands in Arkansas, including the Cossetot River, Warren Prairie, and Benson Creek Natural Area.
This program was made possible in part by the Arkansas Real Estate Transfer Tax through the Arkansas Natural and Cultural Resources Council, and by viewers like you.